that is not perfect, such as every single one of us. So how can we ever hope to approach heaven and being with him? The answer is quite simple. We must be perfect, not just mostly good, absolutely perfect. So what do we do when we aren't as perfect as will inevitably happen? We will go to confession. And when everything we do is confessed, we'll do penance and we'll be clean. We will be perfect. Unless we have forgotten to confess something, without truly confessing everything, we cannot be perfect. And if we aren't perfect, we will be doomed to never see God's presence. Now, I do believe I have some things I need to confess myself. Go forth. The Mass is ended.
The people of Wittenberg leave Mass and reconvene in the local tavern.
Kurt, why the long face? Are you worried you forgot to confess something?
Well, Father Martin must be right. If we want to please God and God is perfect, we have to rid ourselves of sin and be perfect too, right?
But if he said we have to confess our sins, maybe he's telling us to sin.
That's
out of bed when I woke up. Then in class, an afternoon, one of my students was asking the stupidest questions, and I got very angry with him for being so dense. And then, when I was doing someone's confession last night, someone brought in an indulgence, and I thought awful things about the Pope, which I'm confessing because I know that's sinful, but I want to talk to you about those indulgences.
You know, sometimes I wish you'd show up here and tell me you've murdered someone.
You could say you've murdered someone, but I would get to tell you that God has forgiven you. Your conscience would be clear, and that would be the end of that. But without any good, juicy sins, you scrounge around on the ground for every little thing you've done.
Father Stalfitz, you know that even if I had murdered someone, I would still have to confess the little things. Sin is sin, and even the prideful thought that I have very few sins could put me in hell for eternity. All due respect, Father Stalfitz, but sometimes I just don't think you take the wrath of God very seriously.
All due respect, Doctor of Theology Luther. But sometimes I don't think you take the love of God very seriously.
I do, and all of humanity is working very hard to earn God's love and approval.
Martin, you have been in confession for 6 hours. I think that's enough fear of God's wrath for today. Has it ever occurred to you that you might be the one who's angry with God? Good day, Martin. Maybe you should take a walk.
Martin leaves the confessional. He is stopped by his fellow professor, Philip Melanchthon. As they discuss, they arrive on the bustling streets of Wittenberg.
Dr. Luther, if you have a moment.
I rarely do.
Actually, I was looking at the Bible for my Greek class tomorrow, and I was looking at the part in Romans, where Paul says we're justified
by... Dr. Melanchthon, I apologize. I have a class of my own to prepare for.
Yes, Dr. Luther, I understand completely.
Maybe we could talk tonight. Although I was planning on catching up on my daily prayers, and that may take several hours.
Maybe tomorrow. I really wanted to know about...
Ladies and gentlemen, and may I have your attention, please, attention, please. Are you wallowing in your guilt? Are you crushed by the weight of your sin? Are you scared when you reach those pearly gates the big man won't let you in? Thank goodness our good Pope Leo has got our solution right here. My name.
Pope neither desires nor is able to remit any penalties except those imposed by his own authority or that of canons. The Pope cannot remit any guilt except by declaring and showing that it has been remitted by God. And I am an expert of remission by God. Oh, I shouldn't be so sarcastic, I'll have to confess that. What makes me think I can publish something about how indulgences can't save you? I can't even figure out how to save myself. Maybe indulgences are as good as guess as any. But salvation isn't guesswork, it's been taught to us. We have been told so many times about the righteousness of God and the justice of God and his detestation of the unjust. How does the verse in Romans go? The righteousness of God is revealed. I'll look it up when I get back from the outhouse.
Luther exits himself. After a short pause, he bursts back into the room.
The righteous will live by faith. The righteous will live by faith. The righteous will live by faith. That's how the verse goes. God, what have I been doing all this time? Fighting for perfection, fearful to look at your image when you freely give your righteousness with just pay. My faith is why I know I'm going to heaven. What a revelation. I have to tell Professor Melanchthon. Melanchthon, Philip.
Archbishop of Mainz,
I hope this finds you well.
I have a couple thoughts on indulgences you sell.
I know
one all that special. I simply want debate.
I just want to make clear and set the record straight.
I found no Eric scripture that salvation can be sold, and it's such a sorry picture. To clear things up sincerely.
should do that, shouldn't I?
Luther goes out of his room into the monastery.
Father, stop it! Father, stop it!
Father Martin, I'm pleased to see you in such good spirits recently.
Yes, my recent discoveries in scripture have certainly changed things.
Good. I will not miss hearing you confess for hours at a time.
Yes, thank you. I just have one question for you.
Yes?
You've read my theses, yes?
Everyone has read them.
I've been invited to debate my ideas.
You love to argue. That should be fun.
I'm just concerned about how my ideas may not be entirely representative of the order, and I would like to have your permission before I go.
You wouldn't need my permission if I kicked you out.
Please be serious.
No, I am serious.
I
could absolve you of your vows of obedience to the order.
I really don't want to leave the order.
You would be free to speak your mind without having to worry about us.
As much as I appreciate that, I don't think...
People need to hear your ideas, Father Martin. I absolve you of your vows to the order. Please don't argue with me. Save all your arguing for the debate. Show them what you found in scripture.
Yes, sir. Will do.
Scene 4, the debate at Leipzig. The debate is extremely well attended, with scribes taking furious notes.
Let's talk about papal and lord.
I thought you wanted to talk about indulgences.
But your writings on indulgences appear to challenge papal authority. It is agreed on that when Peter became the pope, he gained the power to offer the kingdom to sinners, meaning it should be completely within his power to sell indulgences if he sees fit.
Peter was never really considered a pope. The idea of the pope's authority is one that developed over time through history. It was not only until a few centuries ago that documents mentioned that he has this kind of power over sin.
There are documents from the first century.
Forgeries. I have research to prove it.
Challenging the absolute authority of the pope is a bold statement, Father Luther. It's one that other people declared heretics have made.
Just because a heretic said it doesn't mean they're wrong. I mean, saying that the pope has authority to let people into heaven would be giving a person the equivalency to Jesus. That can be considered heretical.
Oh, what do you mean by that?
I mean, Jesus is Jesus, and someone claiming to be equal in power to Jesus would be... Wow, I guess that would make him the Antichrist, wouldn't it?
Did you have to call the Pope the Antichrist? What do I do?
capable monk, and I still am for now.
I no longer recognize the authority of the Pope or any of his council, so if you can't show me error in scripture or through reason, then I have no reason to think I'm wrong. I will not, I cannot recant anything I've said. Here I stand, I cannot do otherwise, so help me God, amen.
This is
not
I have a lot of work ahead.